The source is the Billing Cat, which has a very close link to the British Special Services.
We are concerned about our security. I mean, we've had Russian state officials lie about us.
So Billing Cat is not a media. This is the tool for the deep establishment to leak certain things. What you're telling now, that everything what was published in the Billing Cat is the truth. We don't believe it.
We've been targeted by hackers as well from Russia on multiple occasions. And of course, with identifying Russian assassins, there's questions about how safe we are because of that.
You kept saying that Bellingcat being a tool of a deep establishment. What is the evidence?
I cannot present you the evidence, but we have a feeling.
It's like now when I travel to hotels, because of these Russian poisonings, I won't eat in the hotels. If they leave something out like a cake or an apple, I'll chuck it in the bin straight away. I'm Eliot Higgins. I'm the founder of Bellingcat. We investigate a range of topics, including the downing of Malaysian Airlines Flight 17, the poisoning of Sergei Skripal in Salisbury, and the poisoning of the opposition leader Navalny in Russia. We have 20 members of staff. They were like really diverse. I mean, they have all kinds of backgrounds. We have someone who's working for Microsoft in Finland, someone who is kind of doing business intelligence for a bank in the US. We have someone whose father looking after his disabled daughter who had a talent for 3D modeling. Like a real range of different backgrounds.
We're in the kitchen of Eliot Higgins.
I'd kind of grown up on the internet and I was, always on forums and argued with people online whether or not videos were real or not. In 2011, the Arab Spring had been going for a while and Libya was this kind of escalating conflict. I didn't have any experience or background in analysis or investigation. It was just the kind of mainstream media were ignoring it because they felt they couldn't verify it. And often it was like, oh, how do you know where this was filmed? And that's why I kind of stumbled into doing what we now call geolocation, which is using satellite imagery to compare that to video footage that might be from anywhere in the world and use various landmarks visible in both the satellite imagery and the video to figure out exactly where these videos were taken. It was one of the first videos I actually ever geolocated. It was a place in Libya called Tiji. Rebel groups in the area had claimed they had captured this town, but there were questions about whether or not it was authentic. So I looked at this video and I thought, well, I can see this mosque. It's got a dome and a minaret, and it's next to this road, and the tank's running down the road. It's two lanes of traffic, so that's pretty wide. So I went to Google Maps and I looked at the satellite imagery and I saw the local area. And in this local area, there is a long road running through the center of the town. And if we follow that road along, we actually come to a location where there's a mosque with a dome and a minaret. And if you start looking at the smaller and smaller details of it, you can actually see that it's not just the dome and the minaret that matches, but the wall that's next to it, the curve of the pavement near it, the position of utility poles, buildings, and all these other details. And that allowed me to confirm this was exactly the location in the video. And it was the first time I had to use this kind of technique called geolocation. It kind of became like a puzzle to solve with each new video. It was just me, playing spot the difference with, satellite imagery and videos. By 2012, the conflict in Syria was escalating and there were kind of more armed groups appearing. And I wanted to know what weapons they had, so I started examining them. And then bombs started being dropped on these people and mortar shells, so I started trying to ID what they were. And because there's such a vast amount of information online about Soviet-era weaponry, like really detailed information, it was possible from even fragments of these bombs to figure out exactly what bombs were being used. If I saw a weapon, I could figure out what it was really quickly. But there started being these videos being shared online by rebel groups in the south of the country with weapons that I'd never seen before, completely new. And I was like, well, what are these? And they didn't seem to be anything that had been used in that region before. I basically discovered this kind of secret weapons exports from, the former Yugoslavia being smuggled by the Saudis through Jordan to the rebels in the south by watching YouTube videos. I launched Bellingcat on July 14th, 2014. 3 days later, Malaysian Airlines Flight 17 was shot down over eastern Ukraine, a passenger plane that had 298 people on it. And it became this huge international incident. We've been really able to document Russia's involvement with the shooting down, despite their continual denials and propaganda and disinformation. The first thing we were able to show was the route of the missile launcher filmed and photographed on the day MH17 was shot down. We've also not only been able to show where the missile was in Ukraine, but track it through Russia, because a few weeks before MH17 was shut down, there was a convoy of Buk missile launchers that went to the border with Ukraine. And one of those missile launchers had damage and markings that matched perfectly to the one that was in Ukraine. So we were able to prove that Russia supplied this missile launcher. The cockpit section of MH17 broke off and landed in a field of sunflowers. People then went to it and started taking photographs of it, walking around it. I took all those photographs, I put them in order. So it was like a Google Street View of this aircraft that was in pieces. Within a day or two, we were able to establish that the front left side of the cockpit had been peppered with what appeared to be shrapnel. And there was no other damage like that anywhere else on the aircraft. It was shown this is where the Buk missile that shut it down exploded. A few years ago, Russia published a series of posts on social media claiming that it had irrefutable evidence that the US was helping ISIS to recover its combat capabilities after fighting in Iraq and Syria. And in this post, they had a number of photographs that they claimed were from drones that show this happening. But I had actually recognized that one of the photographs looked a bit suspicious. It was claimed to be an ISIS automobile convoy. But I looked at it and I thought that it looks a bit blocky, a bit weird. And I thought back to kind of my days of gaming where you have kind of AC-130 gunships where you kind of sit with the black and white imagery shooting things. So I searched for AC-130 gunship simulator on YouTube. And the first result was actually the same video they had taken the screenshot from. It was a computer game. You can tell it's a computer game because there's a big red fire button on the bottom right-hand corner. And this is exactly the same footage they'd been using for their irrefutable evidence that the US was helping ISIS. So they were literally caught using computer game screenshots as evidence. Our next kind of really big story, I would say, would be the Skripal investigation in 2018, where there were two suspects in the poisoning of Sergei Skripal in Salisbury. And they claimed to be sports nutrition salesmen. They gave this big interview on Russia Today saying we came to visit Salisbury's famous 123-meter spire. And we actually were able to show using basically leaked data from Russia, because Russia is a very corrupt police state, so you can purchase actually pretty much anything you want about anyone. And we did that about the spies and revealed they were actually two GRU officers. We also then connected that unit they belonged to another assassination attempt in 2015 in Bulgaria that then led us to the discovery of Russia's secret nerve agent program, which had supposed to be shut down, but we tracked all the scientists to new scientific labs where they just happened to be working together and calling up the assassins in these poisonings just before they did the poisonings. When Navalny was poisoned in August 2020, we looked at those people again, discovered they were talking to some FSB members who just happened to be part of a team that had been following Navalny on 40 separate trips, including the one he was poisoned on. And now we're investigating more poisonings by the same FSB team. So that whole story is basically stumbling across Russia's secret nerve agent based assassination program. We not only have kind of, you know, these details, but we've got phone records, travel records, photos, just masses of information about this secret nerve agent assassination program. We are concerned about our security. I mean, ever since 2015, we've been targeted by the Russian media. If I'm traveling about, I don't talk about my travel plans until after I've done the traveling. But when you're doing kind of events, because you're not attracting kind of the attention, just the attention of Russia, but also basically lunatics who think you are part of the CIA and they think you might need a good stabbing. So you get really nervous when you do certain events.